Manga presents this unabridged recording of
Fair Go Sport, inspiring and uplifting tales of good folks, great sportsmanship and fair play. Written by Peter FitzSimons, narrated by Jake FitzSimons. Introduction. The idea for this book is simple. In the year when Australian cricketers have colluded to nakedly cheat, when attendance rates for all of soccer, rugby union and rugby league have either drifted or roared south, there is an obvious disaffection with modern sport and all the grubbiness that has come with it. Over the last 30-odd years, in articles and books, I have tried, among other things, to capture the best, most inspiring and most heartwarming tales of sports, together with profiling the characters who gave us that magic, or at the very least, engaged us. One thing that became apparent over the years was that there was frequently more reaction to stories about unknowns and golden greats of yesteryear than the modern big bird professionals. What follows is a collection of what I regard as the best of such tales. Most, but not all, are Australian-based. Ideally, they represent the best of sport, or at least the most alluring and inspirational, before the seriousification of the whole shebang started to squeeze the life out of it on so many different levels at once. I do hope you enjoy the reading as much as I enjoyed the writing and gathering. Peter FitzSimons, June 2018, Sydney. The Inspirational. Every morning in Africa, a gazelle wakes up. It knows it must move faster than the lion or it will not survive. Every morning a lion wakes up and it knows it must move faster than the slowest gazelle or it will starve. It doesn't matter if you are the lion or the gazelle. When the sun comes up, you better be moving. The late, great Roger Bannister on life. We'll still love you, whether you kick it or not. Wallabies captain David Pocock as he handed the ball to stand-in kicker Mike Harris to kick a goal to win or lose the test against Wales in Melbourne, 2012. It was only Harris's second test. He kicked it. I thought competing in the yellow suit was tough, but Sally Pearson is out there doing it in her bra and undies. Anna Mears with the quote of the 2016 Rio Games. A classic tale. In March of 1956, down Melbourne way, they held Olympic trials and in the 1500 metre, young Ron Clark, a teenager, found himself up against a star-studded field that included the best distance runner in the country, John Landy. From the gun, the runners went out hard. Clark was up near the front of the field while race favourite Landy sat in behind, planning for a strong finish. Turning the bend with 600 metres to go, the flying feet of one of the runners extended the barest fraction too much and clipped the heels of young Ron. "I was down on the track before I even knew what happened," Clark once told me. For Landy, just behind him and closing fast when it happened, it was like the way it is when you've hit the brakes on a wet road on a sliding forward, powerless to stop, whatever you do. For as Clark sprawled on the track before him, Landy was unable to avoid bringing his right foot down, and his spikes went into Clark's left shoulder. Still, Landy had kept his balance and was entirely capable of running on. But he didn't. He was concerned Clark had been really hurt, so he stopped and turned back to help him up. "Are you all right, Ron?" he asked. "Yes, yes, go, go, run," Clark replied. When Landy continued on in the race, the rest of the field had by this time moved 35 metres ahead, and the rest could have been taken straight from a boy's own book on running heroes. With the crowd screaming themselves hoarse, willing him faster so as to catch the other runners, Landy tore after them, covering the next 200 metres from that point in an almost unbelievable 25 seconds. And of course, he went on to win. Super story, that. The legendary English journalist Ian Woolridge of Daily Mail fame was one day playing golf with his great friend Richie Beno and faced a shocker of an approach shot over an expanse of water. Fearing what was going to happen, Woolridge replaced his new ball with a somewhat bruised and cracked older one from the depths of his bag. Beno, ever the sportsman, noted his rival's caution and, reaching into his own bag, tossed Woolridge a virgin ball still in its cellophane wrapper. "Use that," he instructed. Though he didn't say it, his point was clear. By reaching for the older ball, Woolridge was conceding the shot would go awry before even hitting it. And I am sure you are way ahead of me. For of course, Woolridge stepped up and smacked the ball beautifully to see it land within trickling distance of the hole. He looked across at his opponent. Beno gave him a lovely, wry smile. Ever the master of the significant pause, he knew that nothing needed to be said. In the words of reader Alastair McGilvray, who sent me the story, "Bless you, Richie. When you were at the mic, it was always summer." Two great golden girls. It was one of the great moments in Australian sport. You see, when Raylene Boyle won gold in her last race at the Brisbane Commonwealth Games in 1982, roaring home in the 400 metres, the stadium roared even as the nation came to a standstill. Raylene, a beloved figure, who had been denied gold in the previous two Olympics at the hands of East Germans, say no more, had at least and at last the perfect finish to her career. And who has been organised to present the medal at such an emotion-charged, proud national moment? Why, none other than Betty Cuthbert. Betty, a legend of her own time, had three Olympic gold medals to her credit from a quarter century earlier, before she contracted multiple sclerosis, which is why in 1982 she was mostly wheelchair-bound. But not for this occasion. No, to give Raylene her medal, Betty is determined to do it on her own two feet, and now, painfully, slowly, makes her way forward, unaided, right to the dais in the centre of the stadium. As the crowd roars even more, she presents the bronze and silver medals, and now reaches up with the gold medal to put it around the neck of the crowd's heroine, while the big screen flashes the very words the announcer is intoning to the stadium. "Raylene, our golden girl." But now, as Raylene leans further forward, it brings her mouth in proximity to Betty's ear, enabling her to whisper, "Don't believe it. There's only one golden girl, and it's you, Betty Cuthbert." Betty's knees buckle with emotion. And yet, though hands reach out to support her, she waves them away, stands tall for the national anthem, then makes her way, still upright and unaided, 100 metres or more back into the bowels of the stadium, using all those qualities of pride, resilience and strength that had made her such a champion all those years ago. Just one step inside the tunnel, however, the instant she is out of public view, she collapses into the arms of officials. There is a flood of tears, of pain from the multiple sclerosis and sheer emotion. It takes a while, but after she sobs out the story of what Raylene had said to her on the dais, everyone within earshot is crying too. Nigh on two decades later, at the Sydney Olympics, tens of thousands of spectators cheered Betty on as she entered the stadium, pushed in her wheelchair by none other than Raylene, carrying the Olympic torch. Betty died in August 2017, aged 79, in Mandurah, Western Australia. A fitting farewell. There were many high points to the state funeral of former Wallaby captain and key ARU president Sir Nicholas Shahady at St James Church on Wednesday, but none higher than the wonderful eulogy delivered by his son, Michael, starting with the account of the birth of his father, when the doctor said to his mother, "Congratulations, Mrs. Shahady, you've just delivered a baby elephant." It brought the house down, a house that included Latou Sydney, starting with three former prime ministers, the Governor-General and the Premier, and continuing with the likes of Bob Dwyer, Simon Poidevin, and Nick Farr-Jones. One of Michael's themes was the humble beginnings of Sir Nicholas in the mean streets of Redfern, and how he never lost that humility, or the strong friendships he formed there. He fondly remembered those days with his friends, Michael said, and once told me that whilst he was Lord Mayor, there wasn't one garbage strike in the city, as all the garbos had grown up with him. Sir Nicholas's wife of 61 years, Dame Marie Bashir, sat in the front row in elegant black and laughed lightly and knowingly. When it came to the story of their romance, however, Michael outdid himself. With great pride, Michael recounted how it started in 1953, when he was a famous, hulking wallaby prop, and she was a petite medical student at Sydney University. The relationship was a surprise to many who regarded their interests as very different, Michael recounted. But it was a simple gesture that won my mother's heart. Mum was undertaking a student paediatrics term at the Royal Alexandra Hospital for Children. She was caring for a desperately ill child who had recently been abandoned by his family. There were no visitors or toys. Naturally, Mum was deeply distressed and told Nick of her sadness for the child. The next day, Mum walked into the hospital to find the little boy's cot filled with toys and teddy bears. Again, it brought the house down. That was the Sir Nicholas we knew and loved. At funeral's end, as the coffin was placed in the hearse and the crowd pressed close, the clear sound of a referee's whistle pealed, playing that distinctive tune. Full time, Sir Nicholas. Well played. And too many victories to count. No stopping, Kurt. In late 2006, I received an email from a young bloke who said he'd like to chat, face-to-face, about doing the Kokoda track. As I had done a book about it, and had walked it, he thought I could give him some tips. Sure. We arranged to meet for breakfast the following week at a cafe. He turned up right on time, and I was surprised. For the fellow that turned up was in a wheelchair. Is it feasible, he asked, for me to crawl the Kokoda track? That was an easy one. No. It was a physical torture that gutted the able-bodied, let alone those with a disability. So, despite your courage in even thinking about it, the answer is no, no, no. Still, he was a lovely bloke, about 25 years old, and he told me something of his story. Born in that lost speck of a town called Carcor in western New South Wales, with a condition that affected the lower part of his spine, he had never been able to walk, and he'd made the best of things thereafter. What helped enormously was being the youngest of a large and loving family, all of whom told him he could bloody well do anything he wanted regardless. And Carcor felt the same. He was 14 when some of the fine citizens of that town decided to put money together to get him a wheelchair racer and send him to Denver to race. My parents tried to stop them, Kurt recounted, but they said, "You stay out of this. It's between us and the young fella." In 2 weeks, they'd raised 10 grand, and he was soon on his way, winning the race for his age division. "My whole world changed," he said. "I realised there were people just like me, and lots of them. I'd found my community. They changed my life." Fabulous. But crawl Kokoda? I repeat, no. Of course, this young man, Kurt Fernley, seeing as you ask, ignored my advice and did indeed crawl the whole way. He dedicated his feat to Corporal Tony Metzen, who, back in 1942, had taken a bullet to the ankle at the Battle of Isharava and who subsequently crawled the whole way back, refusing to be borne on a stretcher. He reckoned they were for the blokes who were worse off than him. Michelle, our belle. Most of us felt that when it comes to horse racing, stories just don't get any better than Farlap, the once-in-a-century horse that won the Melbourne Cup in 1930, carrying the hopes of a nation and no few mortgages on his back. But then we were forced to take a really close look at the events that unfolded on the first Tuesday of November in the year 2015. This was the stuff of life, the stuff of sport, ups and downs, swings and roundabouts, yin and yang. This was the ballad of Prince of Penzance. For if there is one thing that rivals this nation's delight in a champion proving itself to be just that, it is an underdog that proves to be a champion after all. And when you have an underdog riding an underdog, and the top underdog proves to have a backstory that would kill a brown dog, well, friends, you are in story heaven. For this yarn, start with the horsey Prince of Penzance, a no-hoper, dog food in a still ambulant pose. Never got close to winning a major race. Constantly broke down. History of sickness and injury. Getting old now. 6 years old. When its odds came in at 101-1, some experts were surprised that the odds weren't higher. Couldn't win the race with a 100-metre head start and a jetpack on their rear fetlocks, one form guide described the six-year-old. Prince of Penzance has a good trainer, jockey and barrier. But if you draw him in your office sweep, your best bet is to swap tickets sneakily with the office drunk.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.